for coming. Stan Kowalski, Mayor of Oakdale. It is a town hall meeting by our local legislator. I'll let them introduce themselves. I think we can have a discussion on a wide variety of topics. I'd like to mention, though, we have Paul Reinke from the city council here, too. So maybe each of you can introduce yourself, but thanks for coming. Thanks for the great turnout.
Good evening. I'm JoAnn Ward. I represent 53A, which is the southern part of Oakdale and a few other places. I'm very grateful that you all came when you got the discussion, and thanks to the city of Oakdale for hosting this. Senator Wiger for initiating it. I appreciate that. I would just mention that I've been in Idaho for the last 3 days. I just got off the phone a couple of hours ago. And working with the entire Idaho legislature on civil discourse, it was the first time I was one of eight facilitators to have this conversation to help people learn to work together and listen to each other and be respectful. And that's something that I've been working on with the Minnesota legislature and hoping that we're going to do it all legislature, bicameral and bipartisan workshop in the near future.
Thank you. My name is Chuck Wiger. I'm a state senator for District 43, which includes most of Oakdale, quite a bit of Maplewood, North St. Paul, and then out into White Bear Lake, Montevideo, Birchwood, and Willerney. I also want to mention my committee administrator is Nancy Livingston, who's here. I chair the Senate E-12 committee, early ed through 12 for policy and finance. Nancy is also a member of the North St. Paul Maplewood Oakdale School Board, so she's got a couple of hats that she has today. We'll have a chance to comment on a number of issues, but because we have such a great turnout, I'm going to just get that quick introduction, and then we want to hear what you have to say.
Hi, good evening, and thank you everybody for coming. My name is Susan Kent, and I'm the state senator for District 53, and so I represent the same area that JoAnn does, so that includes Oakdale, so that's 10th Street down in Oakdale, South Maplewood, Lambeau, and then I represent the entire city of Woodbury. Excited to start a new year. We've got a few weeks yet till we'll start session, but this is a great opportunity to hear what's on your mind and talk about kind of where we think things are headed. I serve with Chuck on the E-12 Education Committee. I'm also on the Higher Education and Workforce Development Committee, and I'm on the Senate Transportation and Public Safety Committee and serve as the vice chair there. Thanks.
Hi, everyone. I'm Leon Lillie, and I'm in a Minnesota house. And I represent North St. Paul and part of Maplewood and much of Oakdale. So I can't believe everybody's here. Big night, lottery winning. I hope one of you win. you can buy coffee next time if you do. Maybe some donuts. So we're kind of counting on some winner up there. It's good to have this opportunity to come out tonight, and it's kind of neat to see the signs and different things and that people are interested and care about, and that's what it's about. We are here to listen and hear what is important to the people of the area and the state, and it's pretty humbling to do what we all do at the Capitol, but it's fun to actually hear what's important to everybody. I serve on a bunch of different committees. I'm on the Capital Investment Committee. This year is going to be a big investment year in infrastructure, so we're working on that. And I'm sorry, but we can't cancel the Viking Stadium after the big loss, but that's still going forth. And what else? I think the governor's coming out tomorrow with his proposal. Much of it's going to be about water. I mean, when you think about Minnesota, I mean, we're really a state that's, one of our things is prided on all our lakes and good outdoors and living, quality of living. And how you would measure that is having a great education system that Senator Wiger has worked on so hard for so many years, and all of us as a state, we thrive there, but also having a great, strong environment. And anyways, I'm not gonna go through all the committees. There's about five of them, so thank you.
I'm Paul Reinke with the City Council of Oakdale, and I wanna say welcome, and also thank you to our elected state officials to come and listen and talk with us.
Okay. Well, this meeting's for you, so let's open it up, and if you want to identify who you are, please do that, and we don't have a microphone, but please speak up.
Marv Johnson, Oakdale, and I see there are some plans in the work for improvements on 36 at Hadley. And a few years back, we had improvements at English and McKnight and Margaret. Last year, we had improvements made at Hilton Trail, and now this year, it's going to be Hadley. I want to know why the most severe intersection has been ignored, 36 and Century.
Well, the projects are all submitted. We have been behind all of the proposals. And by the way, we're very pleased with the recent announcement for Hadley. I know the City Council had been actively working on that. We've been involved on the other ones as well for 36, as well as the entire corridors around here, 36 and 94, 694. For work for 36 and 120 that is still in queue. We still need to advocate for that, but quite a bit has been done. It's a process that is evaluated through the State Department of Transportation, and it's a matter of continuing to advocate needs. Many of these are being addressed. Is there more to do? Yes, there is.
Well, common sense would dictate to me that the most severe backup would have been taken care of first, and that is definitely Century and 36. But now they've built a pedestrian bridge over Century just south of 36. So if any time in this millennia they're going to get around to Century and 36, they're going to have to rip up that bridge, which isn't very old, and start from scratch. And it doesn't seem to me like a very common sense approach, which I believe should have been looked at first.
Well, I will mention on the bridge, we've had a number of people that have almost died walking the gateway. Mm-hmm. And there, in fact, one person, I believe at Hadley, it was at Dorian Grilly, that nearly died. And the people have appreciated that there's a way to go on the trail. And
well,
so
that's nice. I'm not denying that. But how many have been killed in automobile accidents at Century and 36? I know there have been a lot of accidents.
I'll just speak up on that. First of all, Paul and I and the rest of the council thank you for the dedicated funds for Hadley and 36. That's scheduled for, it's not firm, but it's looking for 2019. We've always been consistent, though, with council direction that they're kind of joined at the hip. So we're very hopeful that Century would be done somewhere very close to the 36, because why correct one intersection when you don't have the other one? So it's undetermined. We met with the legislators a few weeks ago and yep. followed that up with a letter saying that transportation and road funding was really a key element.
Mm-hmm. So yet again, at some future period, they're going to block off 36 yet again.
We looked at, this is over the, going back a couple years ago, looking at plans, detailed plans, and how the intersections work and how they could be done. And it was inconclusive as to, do you do both simultaneously or do you lag? And there's a lot of interest, so.
Marv, I just want to just add a couple of seconds. I think it really is it's a good thing. Yes, 120 certainly is important, and as they finish the bridge in Stillwater, I mean, it'll be the, you know, when they get the Hadley done, it's going to be the last intersection really on the whole corridor. So, and it's, but it's coming. It's a very complicated, tight corridor. There's a lot of jurisdictions. There's a bunch of cities, you know, two cities. You've got the counties. It's and of course us, the state. But it's I got to give a lot of credit also to Oakdale and to the whole East Metro. I mean, we fought hard. We're one of 11 projects throughout the whole state that are getting money, and it shows about the strength of the East Metro. And you know, some of them are in Bloomington and around, but and many are outstate. But out of all the, you know, there's 134 House members of you know, so for Susan and I, for two members to get, you know, and these senators to be able to get a project out of this transit money and economic development, I don't want to brag, but I'm pretty happy about it.
Yeah.
I think it really shows the good work that's going on at Oakdale. I'm sure you've been over here to Hy-Vee, showing the economic, you know, the redevelopment that Oakdale's done, and it's kind of what's going to happen up there. Keep going with the Fleet Farm, and it'll be a safe corridor. It's coming. You'll be looking back, and it'll be 5 years past before you know it.
I haven't been to Hy-Vee. I don't support non-union shops.
I was just going to add that we are also frustrated. I mean, if we could, we'd do these things, and we'd do them tomorrow. We're not going to, you know, we would like to not have them take so long.
In the meantime, you're probably hoping and praying for a natural disaster to eliminate your lengthy process of eminent domain and taking the shops and homes that have to be taken for improvement at Century and 36.
I don't think any of us, I mean, that's, I would argue, none of us are looking forward to that. It's certainly going to be a challenge. And there's respected long-term business owners there. There's long-term homeowners. It's taken a while.
Yeah. My contention is it should have been done first, and it hasn't.
Can we please get back to what we're here for?
Yeah.
Can I make a suggestion? At a prior meeting, we just went around so that everybody had a chance. Could we consider doing that? No? Too much time? Raise your hand.
We can get moving on.
Not enough time. Well, I think we need to move on.
We need to move on.
Yeah.
Okay. Who'd like to go next?
No. Okay. This is for the people on transportation especially. How much money will it take the state to fix the deficient bridges and roads?
All of them?
Half of them, 50% of them. About how much?
I, off the top of my head, I can't give you that number.
Billions. 485 million?
Millions, billions. No, millions. But
yeah. 485 million would go a heck of a long way, wouldn't it? Why don't you take that money that somebody wants for the bus slow transit through 10th Street, or 4th Street, excuse me, 4th Street, the little two-lane road that's going to be four lanes with buses every 15 minutes slowly going through the east side. Why don't you take that money and put it where it's needed?
Yeah.
So ever have this idea.
Can I answer your question? You had asked a question.
Yeah,
I was going to try to answer.
Okay, go ahead and answer, and then I'll follow up with more.
So, and I believe you were at the community meetings that JoAnn and I both attended many hours listening to. I thought we had really great dialogues, and I don't have a copy of it with me, but the Gateway Corridor Commission has a really handy chart that shows how the funds are allocated and where they're coming from. And one of the first things to note is that of that $485 million, almost half of that would be federal money that is only available for transit projects.
But it's our money.
But they won't, the federal, they will go give it to Utah. So
well,
they, no, hang on.
Send it to Utah.
Let me finish. Well, okay, that's a conversation. Do people want to send, let $200-ish million of federal tax dollars be spent in Utah or Dallas or Phoenix where they're making these investments, or would we like to have that money come here? And I'm not saying we have to answer that right now, but that's the question that's being discussed. But it's not, I mean, to say the $485 million is as if it's community money or state money that is all being spent on this project, as opposed to roads and bridges, it's not an apples and apples comparison, because it has to be dedicated to a certain type of transit project.
Right.
So that's 50% of that money. Now the rest of that money, a significant portion of that would be coming from a CTIB, County Transit Improvement Board, allocation, which comes from sales tax dollars that have been generated that we've all contributed into for years.
That's 0.25.
Yes. But that funding is also only available for transit. That fund was set up to build transit. And that was a big approved process that created that. So the amount of money that we are talking about, whether it would be coming from this, from the state, which is, so bad at this off the top of my head, 10%, and then 5% for Washington County and 5% for Ramsey County. Those are really the only dollars that we're talking about that in theory it would be available for road type projects. So, you know, I know that's not necessarily what people want to hear, but that's how the project will be funded ultimately.
No, I understand that. And then I understand also that people have said, well, it's our turn on this part of town, the east side or this part, to get the money. But maybe people don't want this transit. I hope the leadership is listening to the community. I hope it isn't just some engineer or some politician who wants a fancy resume heading. I hope you're listening, and I hope you're looking at the fact that maybe it isn't the best idea.
Well, I hope you're seeing that, and particularly because JoAnn and I represent the 4th Street
Absolutely, and you're here, and you call
And we're meeting. Here, and we've been around right. for a lot of these conversations, mm-hmm. because we definitely want to hear, and I think they have been very fruitful conversations, mm-hmm. so I appreciate your comments speaking out.
My name is Sia Westfall. I live at 4th and Helmo. So I would be highly impacted by this project. I moved there in 2002 for the quiet, for the access to the freeway to go to work and to see family and to get around. And I moved there because there's a lovely sidewalk where I walk my dog. I am confident that you will take my sidewalk away and destroy my property value and my quality of life by putting in all of this infrastructure. If it's dedicated lanes in the middle or the north side of the road, we won't be able to turn left outside of the property. And in 0.8 miles, there will be 3 or 4 lights and a bus transit station there. There is a tremendous amount of townhomes in Woodbury. If someone is then looking to buy my property because I will effectively be forced for quality of life reasons to move, nobody's gonna wanna buy my home because they can go to Woodbury and not have to deal with no left turns and a whole bunch of lights and the infrastructure that they want, a peace and quiet street. 4th Street is not the right place for this project. I-94 from like the 3M campus east might be a better option, or Valley Creek Road, or 10th Street, where there are 1,000 more businesses and tens of thousands of more potential riders. I've talked to the people in our neighborhood, which is Hickory Lane. There isn't anybody there that wants it. There are very few people that are willing to come here and from their perspective, stick their neck out and tell you, please, for the love of God, no. I'm very thankful that you're listening, but quite frankly, it's not enough to listen. It's not enough just to listen. We don't want this project, and I would implore you, the city of Lake Elmo just said no, that they don't want it and their residents don't want it. I would implore you to say, I know you need this project, but 4th Street is not the right place, and the people there are going to move, and you're going to damage them. And these are good people. So why not go, if you have to redesign Lake Elmo, why not completely redesign the project? I understand that 3M is very important from a ridership standpoint. Kick on to 94 then and go right down 94, just like they've done on 35W South. And please, in that process, you'll save us from having to move and having to adapt to a very different environment, which none of us signed up for. None of us moved there knowing that you were going to do this project. None of us found out about it until this fall.
So if I
That.
And Sia, I just want to thank you for being here. And for those who didn't attend the community meetings that were held, what I want to communicate is that, and those were held, and when we had those meetings, JoAnn and I had the opportunity to have this conversation with the folks who were in attendance. So I'm going to step back a second and make this point. The Gateway Corridor Commission is the body that is working on this, taking all the input, and making the plans. JoAnn and I, as your representatives for this part of Oakdale, we are your representatives. We are here to hear you because we want to, because we care about your viewpoints. we don't actually have an official say in a lot of the nitty-gritty alignment kind of things that you're talking about. That is really a commission responsibility. Obviously, we get to talk to people, and we get to advocate, we get to, you know, have an opinion. But, you know, so just to, because this is a, these are state legislators, you know, there's, I'm saying this for the whole group who were not able to attend the events that you were at.
Please tell them loud and clear that the people on 4th Street who live there do not want it.
But what I want to, what a real point I want to make was at those meetings, and a lot of people attended, which was really great, and so many important points, just like the one Sia is making, was really heard. Detailed notes were taken. They are all being captured. They are all going to be resent out to the neighborhood and the community members because they want this to be an engaged dialogue process. The ideas that have been brought up are being heard and are going to be factored into the decision making. This is not a final, done, finished deal the way it is right now. This is still very much a work in progress, and this is still the time for you to talk to all of your elected officials at a range of levels and share your concerns and your opinions about this. I just wanted to acknowledge what you were saying and make sure everybody knows that this process is happening. Please stay engaged with the Gateway Corridor Commission. Please stay informed with their process. They are actively seeking their opinion.
I want to add to that only that for those who were not at any of those meetings, you can sign up to get updates from the Gateway Corridor Commission, and go to the Gateway website. If somebody doesn't have access to the internet, let us know and we'll connect you so that you get a mailed copy. But you should be able to get the information that you need by staying informed.
Can you send some of us others that I represent, like North Oakdale, to send us some emails? I'm curious. I haven't heard as much.
Mark, we'll get back to you, but there's several other hands up, and I want to...
Yeah, this is to address this, too.
No, excuse me. No, we're going to...
Everybody gets a first turn.
Go ahead.
So, this is for everyone. I came just to hear the legislators. I didn't know 4th Street was on the docket today. So, first of all, thank you guys for coming out and getting your voices heard. I want to draw a little clarity and then a little recommendation. I'm on the Citizens Advisory Committee for the Gateway Corridor.
I'm sorry.
I will support it if it's done responsibly, but to Susan's phrasing, our state legislators actually don't have any say in whether it will happen until probably 2020 or something when you guys write the final check. By that point, it's just going to be who writes the check. For you guys to have a big impact on it, Lake Elmo's city council had a big say in what was going to happen. I'm going to tell you two things. One, your city council is really the body that's going to be able to take more immediate action than your state legislators will. But the second part, because of the mix with Lake Elmo now pulling out, nothing you see today is necessarily what it's going to look like tomorrow. So right now you're going to get a lot of, hey, you know what? We don't know whether it's even going to happen, let alone whether it's going to go down Valley Creek or 10th Street. So stay engaged, keep giving everyone feedback. I've been going to these meetings for 2 years. So I apologize if you only heard about it last fall.
The neighbors were not told. People were not told.
I knocked on, and I think it was Susan or Joanne's pharmacist. I knocked on every single business door, restaurants and so forth, and we put up signs in every Maplewood business within 1 mile both ways. Now, let me qualify. I represent Maplewood.
But how about business?
But what I'm saying is you've got plenty of time. The watch has been set back because of what Lake Elmo did. So stay engaged, keep telling people. The legislators want to hear it, but if you want action, you got to talk to the mayor and Paul and their co-counselors. They're the people who are going to be able to take action immediately. But thank you for coming, and I'm waiting to see what the new plans are with the new changes.
Mark, thank you for that clarification. I want to explain, when he says they put notices in businesses, those were announcements those were public information notices, so that if you went to the library, or if you went to the pharmacy, or if you went to the grocery store, there were signs up. We don't have a good regional newspaper. And, you know, how are people going to find out about anything?
In the Oakdale paper?
Well, they were in there.
Did you write an article in the Lillie News?
There have been articles in all of those papers. There have been press releases. There have been announcements
about the federal funding.
Of hearings.
There's always US mail. You know where we live.
That costs a lot of money.
We get a lot of other junk mail.
I understand it'll cost me a lot of money to move, though, too.
From Mr. Lillie, from Chuck, I get email from people. If you've got my address, you know, anybody can have my address and send me a note.
We talk to other people.
Gentlemen.
Yes. Well, on a whole different topic, I want to put a bug in your ear. That was a play on words. I encourage you all to look for opportunities to add native plant habitat for pollinators. For example, as a win-win for transportation projects, such as we're talking about, and for stream buffers, number one. And number two, I would encourage you all to revoke the really bad, unfriendly neonic thing that passed that said, if a bee lands on a plant and doesn't die immediately, it's pollinator friendly. I would encourage you all to revoke that as quickly as you possibly can the next session.
We had about a month and a half ago now, I suppose, with the holidays, we had a nice hearing, and had about this many more people over at the Maplewood Community Center, and it was we had experts come in from the university and talk about pollinators and, you know, butterflies and bees and beyond. But it's there's a upcoming, the Ag Department, I think, is having one coming up in the next, in February 12th, I think.
I think it's maybe the 8th. We already registered to be there.
Well, thank you. And that's, yeah. And so you can find that, and that'll be at the Wellstone Center, I think, in St. Paul.
Right. There's also something on the 8th of March.
But what he brings up, and if you're not paying attention to it, it's a big issue, and we all have a major investment because of, you know, clearly our food. We're a big producer in the state, and it's complicated, though, to be honest. We have a lot of big egg companies, too, that are fighting, you know, some of the water protections that are going on, and certainly some of the egg issues. But thank you for speaking for that. And
I'm gonna
you could get a copy. I think the Cable Commission ran that symposium, that forum we had, and everybody here was there, and it was really neat. I really enjoyed it with the scientists and everything.
I'm just going to chime in, too, on what Oakdale's doing, because we have a wonderful tree board and an annual spring planting projects, and some of the recent projects have put in pollinator-type plants to encourage that. We've had master gardeners that lived in the area in our local newsletter to do a seminar in their backyard on what not only a wetland buffer, but pollinators. So we're doing a good job of getting that word out and trying to be smarter as a city and encouraging private
three
citizens.
Three wetlands around 4th Street
private
that be
citizens
destroyed.
To do their own. I did want to point out, it's also a good opportunity. I want to thank the legislator for another thing. We were able to get a grant last year for a boardwalk across Mud Lake that'll be a good access to the Discovery Center. And
I know Jane Klein has been very, very active, and she's doing a great job.
It'll get us a good additional walking path, kind of expose people to the lake there. And, you know, it's nice to have plants and vegetations and plantings, but it's nice to get people out and access where they can enjoy them by having trails.
Mr. Mayor, can you just, since you're up, can you just mention, too, about the 3M water?
The PFC update.
PFC. Yes, yeah.
I think that's a
good point. And again, it's with the help of the legislature and ongoing, you know, if you recall, about, you know, 8 years ago, there were new testing techniques to test for these fluorocarbons in the water.
Yep.
And there is a certain amount of fluorocarbon in everybody's body due to different environmental things. But we had a higher level, and especially in certain parts of Oakdale, and it's been studied. What we did 8 years ago was immediately 3M came in and we shut down wells, we put in filtration systems, and there were some wells that weren't affected. But due to that situation of that attack, that being proactive, combined with 3M doing filtering of their, you know, this land, they have some lands where they're pumping water out, well, they're filtering that. So the really, over the last 8 years, the PFCs are dropping to almost half of what they were, and in almost all cases, they're not at a dangerous level at all. Now, we still see where we're a little bit above the national average. We're just through the our human, well, the food that's being packed, and perhaps the Teflon in your cooking equipment. So we're not quite down to where we should be in the perfect world, but we're going to keep working on it. I don't think we're satisfied, but that is coming down in people's bodies. So it's getting safer and safer. And also, we're going to update our website for this information's available. And we've tracked from the beginning, there's, even though you hear people with growing cancer concerns, there's been no viable statistical increase of cancer, so we haven't tracked it. But that doesn't mean it's a health concern, and it's a health concern that we keep improving on. And again, thanks to the legislature, and our city council is very aware of this, to be as...
We've all worked together. It's been a bipartisan effort, and great story. I think it was the lead story in the Pioneer Press today in terms of the progress that's being made. Also on the pollinator issue, we've all worked together on that, and I anticipate that will be
on the water case. Issue, was there one area of Oakdale that was higher than on other areas, or?
On the PFCs?
Yeah.
Well, I carried the bill for to continue the testing on that. And I think what I read in the report that was sent to us was that the levels that are the volunteers who have allowed themselves to be tested from the time that we started treatment, and their levels have come down, their levels are now the same as people who haven't lived there. We're at a normal level now.
There was a neat statistic that said they started tracking people that have moved into Oakdale in the last 4 or 5 years. And there's no added fluorocarbons to their system, meaning that it's controlled enough that anybody coming in isn't adding anything additional to their system. Also, the thing about the dump sites were outside of Oakdale, but we all share the same aquifer, so we're kind of in it together as a county, because that aquifer is big in it. So, you know, we have to make sure the whole county is doing what they can, because we'll share the same water sources. Thank you.
Yes, and everybody will have a chance, so, yes.
Great, my name is Tracy Anderson. I live in North St. Paul. I also work in North St. Paul at Rem Ramsey. So I am here to ask you for your support with the Best Life Alliance and the rate increase for home and community-based services.
Could you tell everyone what Rem is?
REM, yes. So REM is an organization that is a statewide organization, but we have a large presence in your districts with group homes that we work with people with developmental disabilities, mental illness, traumatic brain injury, and then several persons with disabilities who live in their own home. So we go in and we work with them, help them, you know, be part of their communities and jobs, things like that. So for the past, we got a raise back in 2014, and it really was just a little mandate. Okay, we need another increase. Nursing homes continue to get the largest increase, and a lot of people think that we are nursing homes. We are not. We are home and community-based services. And we also need this increase, especially to sustain our workforce. We're losing our workforce, and it's very hard to retain staff, to even recruit staff at what we can give them. So I'm here to ask for your support. I think we've invited all of you to come out and see us in our work and see what we do and meet the people that we work with. A lot of them don't have the means to be here all the time, and part of that is staffing, but they're jealous. If we had adequate staffing in our homes, then they could be more active. So
I just want to thank you for that request and for standing up for the people who do the amazing work that your team does, and for the people you serve. You know, we have had the ability to go, and these are homes in our neighborhoods, and there will be three or four clients who live there, and there are staff there that help them. And I remember when I first visited, it was a very touching experience, because the work that is being done, in some cases, it's older people, and they don't have any family left to take care of them. I met a young woman who was a successful high school student who had a car accident and was left forever altered. And her family was so grateful for this opportunity for her to become building some independent living skills. So the work that you do is so powerful and so important and so not appreciated, because it just goes on in our world around us and we don't have a chance to see it. So I want everybody to understand how significant this is, and it's way less expensive to take care of people in this kind of environment and setting than to have a lot of additional nursing homes and that kind, which isn't best for the clients either. So thank you for your work and for advocating for this issue and for the work that's being done.
Yeah, I'll just add, we did put together a biennial budget last session. The projections now are very favorable for a surplus. And when we start on March 8th and go as potentially as late as May 23rd, there probably will be proposals for a supplemental budget. Transportation, taxes, additional areas in healthcare, education, all of this will be discussed. And that's what the governor, the 201 legislators, and what the public weighs in on. It'll be a combination of a variety of factors. The need that you've cited is very real. It's in our community. It affects a lot of families. And what would we have if there wasn't a place for these people to go? So I understand what you're saying, and I know that your family, the clients that you serve, you provide hope.
Thank you. This gentleman here, maybe we'll go here and then there.
I live in 448 Hickory Lane in Oakdale, and my question basically on the bus transfer itself is, where's the proven ridership for this? I mean, 15 minutes of buses running continuously down these roads where a bus holds, what, 80 people?
60.
What is the justification of four people on a bus maybe three, four times in the morning, and the rest of it is running all day long?
Right. From what I understand, it's a long process, and thank you all for coming. You should be concerned. But I think as we get through this year, a lot more will be known as far as things coming together. They're completing an environmental impact statement. And I think a lot of those details on dynamics of ridership and how the traffic flows, and I think we'll learn a lot more in the second quarter of this year. So that stuff will unfold and we'll learn more. But same concerns, yeah.
The other question I have is,
can I just, to your first question before you go into the next part, just to piggyback onto what Stan was saying. So in those conversations with the neighborhood groups in December, there were a lot of questions about how did we get it with these ridership numbers? Why should we believe them? How, what is that? And one of the things, and again, this is all being sort of compiled and that will all be sent back to the neighbors, was the idea of having follow-up meetings that would dive much more deeply and bring in some of the experts who really could talk to some of that. And so pay attention to what's going on. You will hopefully get the follow-up notices before those would happen. But that's where I think you will get a lot more information. And we can only sort of parrot some of the things we've been told. There will be people there who will be able, in a much more detailed way, to be able to talk about the research and the data that is used to come up with those numbers.
And the last part of my question is, I think this meeting, we're all under the assumption this meeting was set up strictly for the bus transit stuff.
No, we have a town hall. Chuck sets up an Oakdale town hall for our delegation every year before session, and we take whatever questions there are. So, yeah, I don't know where that came across that it was dedicated for the We're certainly glad to hear it. We know what's a concern.
But if we keep the responses shorter, because we're going to be here at 1 o'clock in the morning.
Well, we have to get out before that.
Okay.
In the back.
Yes. I'm really curious. Steve Ellenwood, Woodbury. I got a really radical idea for you guys, if you take it back and give it to the governor. Since this session is going to be a short session, why don't you do an un-session? Meaning, you go back and look at the bills that should be off and sunsetted and get rid of them. We don't need any more spending. We don't need any more tax increases. You guys got $1 billion of our money that you're just sitting there going to go play with. And I'm on a fixed income, and I got 71 cents left until Friday. So I would like to volunteer this 71 cents, because I'm so damn angry that you've already taken more money than what you should out of my pocket. And my roads are still crap. I still have all kinds of things that I'm paying for that I'm getting no benefit for. So I'm just curious, when does the spending stop? When we're all broke or everybody moves out of the state? When does it end?
Yeah.
That is what the discussion will be when we're in session, as to what the amount
is. Is there going to be discussion to give us our $2 billion back?
That might be proposed. There's others that will suggest additional areas that would be addressed as well.
Can I, real quickly on the conversation about budget, because I've had a lot of these conversations in different parts of the community. One of the things that it's by law, when we talk about this surplus, by law, we have to project increases in revenue for inflation and that kind of thing. But overall, by and large, not universally, but for the most part, we do not project inflation for the spending categories. So it's a little misleading when you hear there's a surplus as if there's all this money. If we want to increase and keep up with inflation in our schools, first and foremost,
which we have not done,
there would need to be some amount of surplus in order to do that. Does that make sense?
So let's cut spending.
And so you have, well, in this community, where we didn't pass a referendum recently for 622, those are going to be some very significant cuts in the schools, because we have not kept up with inflation in education spending for some amount of time, and now we're going to have this challenge. So I just want to make sure that everything's clear on that sort of basic math about the definition of the surplus. Yes, and that is a really, thank you, Leon, that's a really good point. One of the things that we did set up 2 years ago, I think, was to mandate that when we have a surplus, a certain portion of that goes into a rainy day fund, so that when we run into harder times economically, we don't have to make drastic cuts to important things like transportation and education and health and human services.
We're going to go here, and Mark. Okay.
I'm going to direct this one to the mayor. Mayor, what's your definition of clean water? Is this water that's chemically clean, or is it clean water? The reason I'm asking this question is I've lived in St. Paul and not had to filter water. I've lived in Birchwood, not had to filter water, but I have to filter it in North Oakdale because of the rust and sediment. And if I don't filter it, it's going to ruin my water heater, it's going to clog up my washing machines, and everything. I'm going to know why I have to filter it if we're getting clean water.
I'm not a scientist, but I have a water softener, and most people in Oakdale do, and from what I understand, the water, because we have different wells, it can vary a lot on its hardness, and it doesn't mean it's on...
It's chemically clean.
It's
not clean water.
And you're making it chemically taste better, feel better, but that doesn't mean that it's no different than being up north where it's iron and a hard water and it dirties your porcelain. That's still clean, healthy water. So we want clean, healthy water. That's what we're achieving. But that's different than do you need to soften your water and stuff.
I don't need to soften it.
And it varies a lot.
I need to clean it.
Right.
I have a filter. I filter all my water.
Yeah.
Why do? Is it because of the wells we get it from? Is that it?
Yes. The minerals in the water.
Where does White Bear Lake get their water?
And you're in North?
Yeah.
No, Oakdale's not that big, run into a lot of people. I don't hear it as a common complaint, people about our water and that. And
I don't know. You know, I'm sure there's some neighborhoods where someone wants their water cleaner in appearance, but
I think, Matt, I'm guessing that the city engineer could answer your question.
They did at my house.
I mean, St. Paul uses river water, and we use well water. I mean, it's a whole different source of where the water comes from.
That's right. And St. Paul does treat their water because it does come from the river. So that it is treated before it gets to your house, and we're on well water.
I have a question for Mr. Reinke. You're on the Gateway Corridor Commission?
Yes, sir.
Are you associated with Silver Oaks Development?
I'm the president and owner of that company.
Does that constitute a
conflict
of interest with this railway or this light transit system going through and you being on the commission? Because I know you're for it. And doesn't that kind of have a conflict of interest because you're a developer and now you're getting a new bus line and oh, look at all the property that I can start developing now?
Like the golf course.
The simplest answer is no.
And why is that?
Because the 3 months ago, I was offered a job with one of my larger clients. So now I work for an outfit called IRET as a development and construction manager for Minnesota. If I hadn't done that, it still wouldn't have been a conflict until my development company might have found a site, put it under purchase agreement, and then received benefit from it. After 11 years on the council, I go to nth degrees to avoid that actual plus perceived conflicts. Because once it's perceived, bad information carries the day. So I've gone to the nth degree to avoid any potential of conflict, actual, factual.
But you're still in the development business, and
thank goodness.
It's really hard for me to.
We're gonna wind this
you know, are you gonna, you know, swear to us on a Bible that I will never do any development along there because I was on the commission and it would be a conflict of interest? I mean,
ma'am, I think I would do that. And here's how serious I.
No, don't
do that.
No, I'm
not
okay.
being flippant at all. I would do that because of my knowledge of what our current business is, IRET, and also my knowledge of what my company is able to do. My company is a one-man show, Silver Oak Development. And you know how much it costs to do anything. So I would be glad to do that because it's not going to happen. Now, the other conflict of interest aspects is really important, but I'm still going to say that I am in favor of the line. I've shared with smaller groups about, look, one woman was great. She said, what in the world? I voted for you, you represent me, and now you're voting for it? I want you to stand up and tell these people no. I said, well, personally, I agree from the data that I have and the process that we're going to go through. Now, my job is to help you clarify the issues, help you understand the data, and how to communicate with the mayor, myself, the elected legislators, county, federal, and express your views because there are more votes coming. So when I say when people say that you voted me or elected me, of course you did. And I do represent you. But because I don't happen to agree specifically, doesn't mean I'm not gonna act in my good faith and what I believe is right for the community and for the region. But if I don't help you express your views to the voters or to the policymakers, then I am a goofball.
So do you
how would you feel if you lived there on the corner?
I would want to understand what do I do to change people's votes or minds who are going to make the policy decisions.
When I get off the bus, what am I going to do there? Stand on the corner and figure out how I'm going to get a ride over to a place of Oakdale or Woodbury?
So I'm going to back up and say the 4th Street is one option. And within 4th Street, there are three options. Somebody talked about the north, center, or south. Depending on where it goes, makes a difference on the people to the north, mm-hmm. many of the townhomes. I've publicly stated that that's a foolish idea to put it on the north because of the implications to all the people. Center causes problems too, and I'm in favor of the south alignment. Okay, set that aside. Another thing that we put in our resolution, and I'm sorry I'm taking so much time.
No, 90% of the people, I guess, are here for this, so.
But one of the things we put in the resolution back in 14 with Mayor Surratt at the time was a series of 14 whereases. But within that was one critical section that dealt with 8 options that had to be investigated and studied before we would vote again in favor. So we're going to get this data, and one of the options is to swing down back to 94 and go along the Hudson and Frontage Road and maybe come up someplace. Well, another option is to do a managed lane on 94. Another option is to do nothing.
There you go.
And when I and Linda, you were great in the article in the Pioneer Press. One of the issues, though, is that dealing with today, I think you were more accurate than not. Dealing with 30 years from now, I'm not sure. In fact, I'm pretty well getting convinced with the data that I'm getting that 30 years from now about how this region is going to work, it's going to be drastically different, as is 94, the big parking lot that will become. So then our challenge then, really simply, is how do we make it the best we can without screwing up the people that live there? And then what you guys are doing, and the more data you have, and I do want to echo Mark's statements, is get involved. It's a pain in the butt. It takes time. You don't think you have to do it. Why the heck should I be doing it when there's people like here that should just, you know, vote for what I want? The process is you need to get involved, and I recommend that you do it. I commend you for doing it. Gateway Corridor, City Council of Oakdale website, the county website, the state website has this information, and then participate in the meetings and then talk with us too.
I just have one more question for you. When you go into your meetings and everything, do you carry any statistics or information that you share with other people each meeting, telling how many people are against certain routes and why? And are you sharing all this information? Because nobody seems to talk about who's in, you know, I never see an article that say, well, so many people are against it and so many people are not, you know, not for it and so many people are for it. I just want to be sure that you have some statistics or something you can say for us people once you're, you know, talking for us.
Okay. The easier answer is yes. Do we take a tally each time we get together and say, the current last month's event was 2,700 people against and 1,800 people for?
I understand that. I just want to be sure that everybody is sharing their information, because I know how hard it is to share, and there's so many important things going on that at least the people that need to know are hearing it from you, seeing as you're on the commission and you're representing them.
I'm just going to say a few things that, just to reiterate, I've been on council with Paul for a long time, and whenever there's a potential conflict, he's been good in a few cases recusing himself, and more times than not just turning down business that could potentially be a conflict, and we appreciate that. And really, all of us on council are there to develop, whether we're developing a good neighborhood or a good business neighborhood. So we're all in trying to make progress in Oakdale. That's good. I did want to point, Paul mentioned the amendments and how we wanted to look. It was very important that they look at alternatives of 4th Street. I think that they're just starting to seriously get that message and start looking at it. That's going to take a lot of time, probably into next year, you know? So be patient, more facts will come. Paul's done he's our key representative, but he does a great job of reporting back to council. If you don't think council's that involved yet, is that there's so much more information to come, so we have to time our involvement. But he keeps us appraised, so does our city staff, so does our commission, and we're always working with our legislature on anything that could be imminent regarding any kind of state involvement. So that's where we're at there. But I would like, though, and I think it's great that we are handling 4th Street, and I was very happy that some other topics got up. It is an open forum for anything happening in Oakdale. So as we get, you know, we don't have a lot of time left, so it would be nice to give a shot at people that have some questions that are not on the rapid bus transit for weekend.
I wanted to say something about the bus transit, too. Nancy, I think I talked with you on the phone. You talked about Minnesota and how we like the lakes and how we, you know, and so a lot of us moved to 4th Street because it's quiet. We've got wetlands, we've got birds, we've got deer, we've got all kinds of animals. And if we put the busing down there, everything will change. So our life will completely change. The other thing is they're doing an environmentalist study and they're not including that bridge in there. You have to look at what impact that bridge is going to take, because you can't take four lanes and put them down to a two-lane road to compare.
Are you talking about the overpass over 694?
Yes.
Okay, I just want to make sure.
Over 694. You're going to have four lanes going into it. You've got bikers, you've got walkers, you've got buses that are going to take precedence. It's absolutely going to be a nightmare if you don't include it, and that's not in the 485. The million. You need to include that in the study.
It's true.
Well, and
for money-wise and for environmental-wise.
It's going to be a cost.
And
that was all captured
in the
Just data again. So the gentleman talked about the year. I already forgot what you said, but it's also, I think, inappropriately crowned. So there's issues with the bridge. But data means that we are taking it into account from actual counts, safety aspects, and what's going to happen when additional traffic goes on that particular bridge, and also when does it plug into the overall state system for replacement compared to other dilapidated, ready to fall apart bridges. You know, there's data that's being
I'm not talking about the 694-94.
No.
I'm talking about the 4th Street bridge. 4th Street over 694.
The competition for dollars, and even though it's acknowledged that I've gotten the county to acknowledge that venture, that funding happens. And again, the crowning that I think is inappropriate, fine at the time, but not today's standards, needs attention.
It's going to be a So the
point is that it is being looked at significantly.
But I keep hearing that. 485 million, and it's going to be more than that if you have to make another bridge.
We had a meeting last week and update Paul and I and our staff and attendance with the planners. And we spent a lot of time on alternatives to 4th Street, also working on details on 4th Street. They're pursuing all options, but a focal point of last week was, hey, we've heard enough from the residents and their concern about that bottleneck, but that's going to be, those are the decisions where we basically said, as we get further down, we may need some of the infusion of money to make this project better, to make it a good project we can all support. I attended a mayor's conference in Minneapolis with regional mayors, and Charlie Zell, as he's commissioner of transportation. He was right there, spoke up on the goal line, along with Adam. Those are the players in the belief of this rapid transit, and I said, you're going to have to, as we work through the process, it would be nice that you empower the city council here and trust us and back us with that funding to make the project good for everybody. Now, we do represent a sensitivity of those that live close to it, but also we've got to look at the greater good of the entire city. So everybody's got a stake in the game, but we like to always try to achieve a win-win where it still can be a good project for those that are near it. So anyhow, it was nice to have the opportunity to immediately face-to-face tell the players, we have some bottlenecks, and I put them on those.
Well, and since I've got the mayor and Councilman Ryan here, I'm gonna mention something that came up in some of those conversations we had. In talking about some of the trails in that area and how they might be affected, it led to a really interesting sort of brainstorming discussion about an opportunity to to work with the city in some cases, or to build it into the gateway plans, to add additional trails in this area, to make sure that if we do, you know, harm the experience of one of the trails because it's near the line, what can we do to enhance the neighbor's experience in that way? And so, again, working in partnership at all levels, and it was a really great conversation, and the folks from the Gateway Board of Commission were, you know, chiming in with all sorts of things that they've seen done in different communities.
Before we move on, I don't know if we're going to move on from 4th Street and stuff, but there's other, we had a workshop with the mayor and the council, and there's other priorities, and I think it's going to reveal itself even more through this upcoming session, is rail safety around the state. And, you know, going across Oakdale is some open rail situations. So, I mean, these are priorities, I think, for us too, that you guys might not even know about. And I know, Marv, you're not totally happy, but certainly one fighting for 120 is and will continue to be a priority. And so there's other transportation, but this session, I think, is really, I mean, if you watch what's going to happen, because it's an election year, to be honest, and statewide interest, a lot of it's going to be this rail safety issue. It's going to be a big, big issue.
Yeah, so. I have one point on the rail safety, because I wanted to bring up, again, I want to thank our legislative body here, because we, our council, we just approved on Tuesday the no train whistle zone. So there's been it's been brought up, you know, I can hear, I live a mile and a half from the train, you can hear it depending on the weather.
You can hear it in Woodbury.
Obviously, people that live closer, and you know, we say the train was there before the housings, but there's been enough improvements that the time has come that the council thinks it's time to have the whistle-free zone. And part of that was all the roads going over the rail now have, you know, over the last few years all have gates, so that makes it additional safety. They can always blow a train whistle if they see down the track some people near the track in potential danger. It's going to take probably up to 2 years to get that fully implemented, and we're asking our state legislature with that there's special construction details to make the intersections even more safe to be train whistle-free. So that's something we're going to be
asking. The rails, you know, the trains aren't just such as lumber going through or cars. I mean, it's a lot of it's, you know, maybe not be right through here, but we got to keep our eye on it. It's, you know, oil from, and it's, you know, it's actually quite concerning. So
yeah, and the rail safety issue is a big one, and there are so many transportation issues. Spent a lot of time talking about one particular transit line in the whole in this area, but there are so many transportation issues statewide, and I'm really hopeful. You know, I remain hopeful and committed to trying to find solutions. This issue of rail freight is another issue that's going to do our heart in this part of the community, which is the 694-494-94 interchange. And I keep talking to MnDOT about it, because as our economy is doing better, we are shipping more and more goods both on the rails and in trucks, and it is putting significant pressure on our infrastructure, and we've got to be able to do that. But, you know, there's no plans, there's no budget for any expansions within that system anytime soon. And back to sort of what you were just saying, there are so many bridges around the state that are structurally unsound that need to be. It is a true urgent situation. Those have to be fixed. The one in our neck of the woods here is structurally sound. It may be a public safety concern, but it is structurally sound. So it falls down the list when we don't have very many resources.
Marv, Chuck, and I'd really like, if you I've haven't got, had a chance to ask a question, we'd really like to.
I don't have any questions, but I've got three statements I'd like to make, and I'll make them brief. Wait. First of all, I spent 40 years working for the railroad, the Great Northern, later to become Burlington Northern Santa Fe. When I was still working for them 11 years ago, they had a program where they were going to replace all at-grade crossings. Then that would eliminate the need for any whistles. I would suggest that you all call the Burlington Northern and start talking to them and ask them what happened to that program.
Yeah.
Second, the issue of water. Not all St. Paul water comes from the river. I lived in the North End near Ryson, Maryland for 51 years. And I had good drinkable water. It came from North Oaks and Lake Badness. through the Thompson Water Works by Lake McCarran's, and it was good and drinkable. The next one is in the 80s, when I was still living in St. Paul, I was asked by the city to serve on an 18-month commission under Commissioner Finley at that time, studying the light rail on the Midway Corridor. We did not recommend going down University Avenue, and as you can plainly see, they haven't resolved the issues of pedestrian or automobile incidents. They should have been aware of it already with Hiawatha, which had plenty of them, and they had a lot less crossings than University Avenue. And our commission recommended the median of I-94, so they would never ever have to move the tracks, which would be a horrible expense. And the commission, the powers that be did not listen to the commission, nor did they listen to the citizens, because they turned around and later decided to go right down the middle of University. And I doubt that the powers that make the ultimate decisions on your bus line or light rail or whatever it's going to be here in Oakdale on 4th Street aren't going to listen either.
Chuck, I just wanted to say that Chuck Nelson, North St. Paul, that in these flush times when we've got a surplus, I hope you're not tempted to say, oh, we got to just give it back, you know, the $600 or $300 whatever Jesse checks that we got years back, that it was a waste of a resource that could have been used to take care of many infrastructure problems. Let's not make that mistake. Let's use the money, the tax money that we pay, to help fix problems in our areas around the state.
I'll beat the lady behind you and then we'll go return to you.
A question regarding the bus rapid transit. I'm wondering if Oakdale already has taken a vote similar to what Lake Elmo took, or if Oakdale will be taking a vote?
So we did, and this was back in September of 2014. Mm-hmm. And at that time, it was called this thing called the preferred alignment. And all that meant is after 4 years of looking at the various options, including the southern route, the Hudson route, the 94 route, the no build route or no build option, the one that seemed to make the most sense from a variety of things. Pedestrian ridership, ease of access, pedestrian ridership, least capital cost, so the initial cost of doing it. One example is, say this is $500 million for round numbers. If light rail, and some of the people wanted light rail out here, that was $980 million. Foolish. So then it's also economic development, and I forget the last one. The other question was, how come not in Oakdale or Woodbury? And it gets down into how do you get through with existing lack of existing right-of-ways. So when we took that vote in 14, it was, here's an alignment, a corridor. I don't know if it's north, south, side of the road, in the center, how it's all going to work. But here seems to make sense with these stops. Oakdale has two stops.
Huh. And that was on 4th Street.
It's funny, the homeowners there never got notified of
it. So it was a real broad, this is where we're
going to make sense. Very interesting, yeah.
We have one more vote coming up, at least one more vote coming up as a council to say, okay, now.
Very interesting that the homeowners wouldn't have been notified of that, that people that live right there, apparently you don't live on that corner. But apparently, it seems odd that we wouldn't have been notified that there was some important vote that could have potentially...
That's been a criticism that we've heard and have taken actions to rectify.
And when do you
now, there's 1%.
So when can we revote?
There's 1% engineering that's been done on a project that takes, that needs 100% engineering before final decisions are made.
Yeah, but I wish it wouldn't have even gone this far.
Can we be notified before the meeting in which a final vote would be taken? Because I think it's important to us that we have a voice at that point.
Well, especially those homeowners that live right in that little corrugated area. Like, that's important.
I would say yes.
Yeah, we can always reach out.
I mean, come on and knock on my door. Leave me a card on the door.
So I guess what we're asking then is that we be told prior to that vote so that we have a voice
to tell you.
Absolutely.
Based on what is being proposed at that point.
Yeah, and it's likely at that point, because we'd be talking more details where the, it would, might be a vote that involves some construction agreement. And then that involves immediate residents.
I mean, unless you guys are willing to buy my townhouse and go ahead and market that.
We have an ordinance that dictates that we notify for that type of improvement in the step. And we can widen that boundary. But I, getting back to the first vote, I think it really in spirit was just primarily a vote to keep the study process going. You know,
the study process, the concept.
Did you vote in that meeting?
So we had such little really.
Did you vote in that meeting?
Did I?
Yes, you did. You have a conflict of interest because you're on the commission.
And he wants it to go through.
And you want it to go through, that I don't think that you should vote with the Oakdale City Council.
Let's explain a little bit about what the composition of the Gateway Commission is. Susan and I are not on it. We often go to the meetings. But, so, there is a representative from every city council.
Yeah, seven cities.
And long and mayors, there is, and you need a diverse experience, background on that commission so that they have some experience to bring to it.
Both counties are on it.
Both counties have representatives on it. It's a pretty broad group. And so every city has representatives. And you want somebody who understands land use.
I agree, but he also wants to sell land there. So how convenient.
That's not
going to
happen.
Whatever.
I don't think that's a fair accusation.
No.
In the city council.
Can I just say real quickly for the question about how to stay informed? If you go online and just Google the Gateway Corridor Commission, they have a website, and within their information, you can sign up for their email and the listserv. If you want, I have their little postcard size cards back there. My email address is on there. Let me also neglected to introduce my LA legislative assistant, Gwenya Fiscal-Gould, is right there. So if you call me, she's the one who answers the phone. And we can help connect you with that right information as well. So if you're not able to find it directly, if you want to just reach out to me, I'll be happy to help make that connection.
So we just want to know when you're going to vote on it.
And that's the listserv that will keep you informed.
There's two agreements then. One is our agreement to spread the word. The other agreement is that you also need to be looking for the word. And that means also signing up.
You have my email, Paul.
But you also can sign up on the Gateway Trail Corridor to be automatically.
And you have my email.
So that's the commitment. It goes two ways.
I just...
The entire council, Paul, because he's got skills and interest, that's how we, I sign up for commissions and committees and the rest of our council. A lot of it's driven by, am I available to serve on that committee? So this, it's full support of council back Paul's desire to be our lead on that commission. So it wasn't like he just signed up on his own. I forgot my train of thought. There's a communication piece that maybe I will check with our city staff, or maybe whether it's a council agenda or an agenda item. Maybe there's a way our city staff can email information out. We've done it, but maybe we can progress a
mass
system
email
on that. I want to make one point too. Someone asked a question about, I think it was you, ma'am, about complaints. We do have a folder. We're keeping cautious, very careful records of written complaints and phone call-ins for that we know who the people are. We don't lose track of them. We just know who they are, and that way, as the, you know, we just know the levity, the amount of people participating.
Is that email or paper mail or?
They keep a record of every communication.
Yeah, we keep a file.
Every communication, they will keep a tally.
Yeah,
I want to add, on the Gateway Corridor, from those meetings that we had in December, all of that, this next meeting, all of that will be recorded. There will be some report from those meetings as part of tomorrow.
So I think we kind of know that issue, and you guys can maybe talk after.
The city's committed to putting on the website the communications, and that's been drilled very clearly, and there's a commitment. And you know, we'd like to get to some of the other questions.
We just run really fast. Your hand's been up forever, and there's a guy back here in the green, and you. And then
my question has to do with elections and would the legislators support or not support a change in the law to only count or to count votes for referendums, much the same way we do for constitutional amendments, so that if it's not marked clearly as a yes, that it counts as a no. And second, would you support there being a supermajority of 60% for any tax, any items or referendums that raise taxes?
I don't know what, I'd like to hear more about it. I would imagine all of us are different on all of that. I typically support a majority wins in much of these votes myself.
I support the majority except on bonding. It says 60%.
At the legislature. So please send us something.
How about the counting of the vote, making it clearly marked as a yes, and if it's not, then it counts as a no?
I would have to understand the language behind that to be able to respond.
I'm really curious because I was involved with one of the state recounts. We went out to Renville County and I was looking at ballots. So can I talk afterwards?
Yeah, I mean, it has to do with the recounting, and it doesn't seem that the direction that the recount boards necessarily follow is consistent and uniform, and so maybe there could be a way to.
That stuff is really fascinating.
We can look into that.
It's amazing how hard it is for someone to do draw in a circle. It's I don't know, really, you get a pen and then they say do a in the circle, and it's amazing what you see. Sir, with the green?
Yeah, they do an environmental study of this route for 4th Street. Are they doing environmental studies for the other possible routes, or are they focusing on 4th Street?
Jim, can you answer it quick? And then
just so I can see you better. The environmental study is not going to be done on as thoroughly on each of the routes.
It's not going to be done?
No. And the comment comes up every now and then back here about the wetlands.
Through the pipeline.
But on the wetland piece, through the legacy management meeting that I went to with a smaller group, they brought up that information, which I shared immediately. And it has to be considered and will be considered.
Did you say they're not going to do an environmental study?
Yes, they will.
Not in detail. Okay, we're down to the last two.
Can you speak to why?
I'm Ms. O'Mara.
Can you speak to why the
Meadow Senior Living Facility?
Yep.
We have over 100 seniors living in assisted, memory care, and independent. And I was quoted in the paper, and I had to look up one of the words in my focus I had never heard of, LIFT. But one thing I'm stressing and we're very concerned about is the safety and the health of our tenants and the access that they will have. Their family moving in with moving trucks, making U-turns, the ambulance coming over for emergency, et cetera. And I just, if you were on the south side.
You're by the church.
We're on the church side, yeah. Correct. So
and you guys kind of got that.
And I would just say really quickly.
And I compliment the group home.
Absolutely. We actually recently, JoAnn and I were with a group, and we happened to have a chance to see a line in Virginia. There's nothing in Minnesota that's exactly like this. They have a whole way of handling like ambulances and that sort of thing. They're called mountable curbs. That's the technical term for it. So there are solutions for all of that. And again, within these dialogues that we've been having, these are exactly the kinds of things that I know everybody's really sensitive to making sure that we're hearing and that you know will be addressed as the planning process goes on.
I'm also, I mean, I totally agree with the MTA transportation in East Metro. And 10 years ago, we did call MTC to see if they could get a bus line coming out here. We were told not in our lifetime, so I'm going to be dying soon. bus speed, an additional 2 lanes is over.
If I can just do one more sentence, sorry, ma'am. One of the things that we did hear a lot of community meetings is that there's already so much traffic of people who skip 94 and go through that street. Well, when Paul talks about how things are going to be in the next 10 years as we get more and more traffic, that's just going to mean more and more pressure. So that was one of the things I brought up in my recent meeting with Linda. You know, what do we need to look at to talk about how how this is affecting the neighborhoods in terms of pushing traffic into off 94, because it's a parking lot. So
but we're told that it's not going to do any good for 94. This is just to move other people. It's not going to help 94. That's what we've been told.
It's going to, 94 traffic and congestion is going to increase. This is going to hopefully keep it from increasing as much and as bad. That's the idea. And the reality is, when you look at the geography of the East Metro, where the rivers run and all that sort of stuff, we just have limited options. So that's why this is one solution. And again, I encourage everybody to follow up with those ridership numbers and really understand where that research comes from.
You know what?
This guy's next. I'm sorry. And we got to wrap up.
John Nowicki from Oakdale. We heard that Lake Elmo said no, so the commission is looking for a new route. We've got a lot of people here from Oakdale that are telling the city council, no, find another route, get it off of 4th Street. Why can't our city council tell the commission, no, find another route?
Ultimately, that is a possibility. I think at this point, we feel it's worth continuing the study. Granted, we want to take care of as many concerns as we can for the people that live near it, but we got to not only look for the vision, just as a lot of comments were, we got to look at beyond the vision of today, what's going to be better for the city in 5 years, 10 years, what's good for the entire city. So we wouldn't be pursuing this if we didn't think, and again, I think Paul's alluded that there's a lot of details and a lot of improvements will have to be made for each one of us to support this. There's nothing telling us that with all potential alternative routes and the devil in the details as we move through the process that it can't be a whole lot better, and we're willing to wait it out, do more planning, and see, again, we want to make sure we're doing what's best for the city for tomorrow, not only for today.
You're chasing good people out. I want you to know that.
So I really want to thank everybody. We're kind of there. Couple more questions?
Yeah, this guy in the Browns had his arm up forever.
Go ahead.
It was just stated that the bus company said not in her lifetime would they route a bus down 4th Street. Now you're going to put mass transit down there. Who the hell's going to ride it?
Amen.
They're going to have a hearing soon, and
hopefully we'll address that.
As far as I'm concerned, there's millions of dollars coming from the federal government, and you guys just want to spend it on something. And I don't think you've got a good game plan of where you're going to spend it.
Yeah.
You're not using common sense. You've got to put it where people are going to ride it. In Chicago.
Hi, my name is Rick Heller. I'm officially represented twice exceptional and print disabled. I'd like to thank the legislature last year that they passed a bill in education that set the reading level or the text difficulty of special education forms for those that work with those. Also, I'd like to bring up just two items, if I may. It has to do with twice exceptional. 2 years ago, we were twice exceptional. We get the statute. They never really had a discussion about it. It's in statute 120B15, and that has to. They added English language learners, economically disadvantaged, and again, twice exceptional. And they went from identification from a may to a must. And I think it would be important to have a hearing or a discussion for the public before the legislature gets started, because I really think that needs to be engaged with the public first. Because really, the legislature needs to hear from the audience regarding that. And also, there's a current draft bill 3301 from last year. Hopefully, Mr. Wiger, Ms. Erickson in the House will perhaps start that discussion with that bill.
Rick, on both those points, we will hear it, and it's probably you and I are the only one that understand what you're talking about right now. But and on the first one that you mentioned, we did follow up with the state law change.
Just so you know, I have filed a complaint with the Secretary of State regarding the automatic machines. They're currently not compliant, as far as I'm concerned, based on statute 16, which has to do with content accessibility law. I found out, for instance, if it really matters for those who are blind or visually impaired or frankly print disabled, those might be individuals that don't quite acquire information and enjoy it in a natural way. However, I was one of the individuals that kind of went in and looked at the machines and how they function. And what I found out, for instance, if it really matters, quotation marks are not read out loud for the blind, and I thought that was relevant to the whole audience for equality and same opportunity, what that might represent. So my understanding, when quotation marks are put on a ballot, that has to do with a person's nickname. Anyhow, hopefully, if anybody can give me any suggestions, I certainly have a data request with the regarding those manuals. Maybe the governor could perhaps.
Mark, I'm going to cut you off.
Before they go, actually, this isn't for them. This is for you guys. First, know they're listening, but guess what? Their votes are going to be many more, and they probably don't know when they are because it's all getting thrown back into the machine because of Lake Elmo. Don't walk out of here thinking that there's a done decision, whether they say there's one or not. Stay engaged through the whole process, and I'm talking 2020, probably before whatever legislators are sitting up here have to write a check. Stay engaged, keep letting them know it's not done.
Which is good, because we don't have to move right away.
No, it might not be until 2021, so. Stay engaged.
As mayor, I want to thank you all for coming. We did spend a lot of time on the rapid bus transit, and that's fine. I'm glad some other things questions were answered, because it was an open forum town meeting. Paul and I, on behalf of the city council, really appreciate our legislature coming to this and being open-minded. So let's give them a round of applause.
Can I just say one thing really quick? If there was a question that we didn't address, feel free to contact any of us.
I just directed them.